first ball.
Tremendous catch, tumbling forward.
And he's bowled.
From the BBC World Service, in association with ABC and All India Radio, this is Stumped.
Hello and welcome to Stumped, your intercontinental hit of news, features and debate from the quirky world of cricket. I'm Alison Mitchell and I'm in Derby, where I've been following the England women's team on their tour matches against New Zealand, playing a one-day series. And with the cricket season starting to draw to a close, the climax of the Men's County Championship as well, of course, so many thoughts are turning towards the winter and the very many unknowns that COVID brings around that.
Hi, it's Jim Maxwell for the ABC in Sydney. Yes, many unknowns as we speak. In fact, the cricket season has started here in Australia with the women, of course, Australian women playing spectacularly well against India in the opening one day. And the same can be said for Western Australia, overwhelming South Australia in the first domestic one-day game. So there is some cricket around, but it is still very much the end of the football season. And hopefully we can have more positive news about the direction the cricket season is heading in terms of welcoming people from other places.
Hi, and I'm Sunil Gupta for All India Radio New Delhi, and it's lovely to be back on Stumped. Of course, there are a couple of things happening in India. The IPL has started after that extended interval, and it's catching the eyeballs on television, though you can't really see too many spectators. But of course, the big news that I'm sure you all know is about Virat Kohli giving up the white ball captaincy to Rohit Sharma, at least the T20 format, maybe the ODI format, and also giving up his RCB captaincy after this particular IPL.
Yeah, a couple of big vacancies there. Sunil, great to have you back with us on the show. It's been a little while. But we're going to start this week's show by talking about the overall situation for international cricket in Pakistan. Because last week, New Zealand's men abandoned their one-day tour on the brink of their first match because of a specific security threat. England then decided to withdraw both their men's and women's teams from the series that was due to take place there in October. Now, no security threat was cited, but the England and Wales Cricket Board said there were increasing concerns about travelling to the region, and they believed, in a statement, they said that going ahead with the tour would, quote, add further pressure to a playing group who have already coped with a long period of operating in restricted COVID environments. Now, it's a statement that's raised all sorts of questions. It's raised all sorts of strength of feeling. And this is what the Pakistan Cricket Board chairman, Ramiz Raja, had to say to the BBC World Service about the situation.
We have gone out of our way to accommodate international sides and have acted very responsibly as part of the ICC cricket fraternity. Just imagine it was the Asian bloc blocking England in stressful times. It's no time really to remind England what we did, or Australia or rest of the world. During pandemic, we were the first ones to come and support England, for example, but we didn't get that response from New Zealand. We didn't get that response now from England.
So got a passionate response from Ramiz Raja. And Jim, you know, understandable the disappointment. I mean, the strength of feeling. There's strength of feeling in Pakistan. There's also a lot of strength of feeling on the England side, from England cricket supporters feeling almost quite ashamed at the way that the team has been pulled out of this, because there was no explicit use of the word security in that ECB statement. And yet discussions seem to only come about since New Zealand pulled out of their tour of Pakistan. So do Pakistan have a right to feel let down here?
Oh, my word, they do. This has been reinforced in many ways by the utterances from the British High Commissioner, who said there was, as far as he could see, no security threat, with the fact that it was only going to be 4 days in Pakistan, one day of quarantine, two T20 games. It's a bad look given how well Pakistan have supported the game in England and in New Zealand. It's a very, very bad look. And it makes you think that the ECB is giving in to the pressure from the players, not to, in inverted commas, overload them with bubbles, but that they'll be happy to go to Australia and play in the Ashes. So I think they've made a meal of it myself, but I haven't seen anything in the British media that would suggest the ECB are on the right path with this decision.
Does seem to be that there's been a lot of pressure coming from the playing side, albeit I understand that the players, you know, weren't approached on an individual or even on a team basis as such. But of course, there are bodies that represent the players. The PCA, of course, being the main body. There are the player partnerships as well for the men's and women's teams. And this, of course, was going to be the first time that England's met a toured Pakistan since 2005 and the first time ever for the women. That goes into the mix just to highlight the significance of this tour. And it's been in the diary for some 9 months. I understand that the ECB chief exec, Tom Harrison, has been on holiday and he didn't even make the call personally to Wazim Khan, the PCB chief executive, to convey the decision. But Sunil, we know there was no mention of security in that statement. And as Jim mentioned, the British High Commission has clearly stated that they supported the tours, that the security advice for England had not changed. I don't even think, from what I understand and from speaking to sources in Pakistan, that a compromise was even discussed. But, you know, if security was the issue, then play in the UAE. If it was about bubble fatigue, then take a different set of 15 players. But again, not that the women's team could have the same bubble fatigue as the men. They haven't been doing the same level of international touring. But, you know, should a compromise of sorts been reached?
I don't think, a compromise was even on the cards from the way that the statement came out from the ECB. And, you know, playing in the UAE, I don't think was an option at all because it defeated the entire purpose of playing in Pakistan, the optics of playing in Pakistan, and that was the whole purpose of this.
Yep.
So that really would not have been a solution. And if I understand what you're saying correctly, a different set of players, but as I said, I mean, that wasn't even on the table. But even if even if you had to say, you know, we're sending these 15 players. Obviously, the implication might have been, well, you know, they're expendable or they're not going to play the Ashes or something of that sort. And that's not a very nice feeling. And lastly, the PCB would have been well within their rights to announce, say, we're sending a second string team. You know, so there are too many wheels within wheels. And I think it just turned out to be a lose-lose situation for everybody.
Let's speak about England's women briefly. And of course, in Australia, they've got the Australia and India series going on. Sunil, it must have been a bit of a relief for India to get out and play because there had been some reports going around about the size of the rooms the Indian team had to quarantine in and whether or not they were able to train during that time. What can you tell us?
Yes, that's right. The reports were out in the newspapers. If you go back to the Australian Open tennis, I remember reading reports about Victoria Azarenka talking about being breathless because she was in a small room and Rohan Bopanna, one of the Indian tennis players. But, you know, I feel, and I'm sure that the players feel, that despite all these problems, at least they're out there in Australia and they're playing cricket. And they could have been, you know, cooped up here in India and playing no cricket. And as a cricketer, you want to play as much cricket as you can. And in fact, the coach of the Indian team, he tweeted this, Ramesh Pawar. He says, he tweeted a picture of his room window with the caption, "As long as you have window, life is exciting." And I think that's absolutely perfect. It's marvelous for him, you know, to give this positive vibe. Because, as I said, I mean, in these conditions, I mean, you're seeing what's happening across the world, but you're out there playing cricket, I think you should be very, very grateful.
If you've got a window, you're lucky. If you've got a view, you're more lucky. And if you've got an openable window, you are extremely lucky. But speaking of cricketers playing cricket, Sunil, you mentioned that Virat Kohli has announced that he's stepping down from his role as T20 captain after the World Cup and as captain of the Royal Challengers Bangalore after this season's IPL. Of course, for the Indian team, he will remain a key batter, key word that I'm using in this week's show as well. You might want to comment on that briefly as well. But yeah, overall, Kohli, I mean, how do you fill those shoes as captain?
Well, you know, actually, he's been the captain of the RCB since 2011. He's never won the IPL. And he's had the biggest names, Xavier de Villiers, Chris Gayle, you name it, he's had them. And you've got to wonder, and the only time they reached the final was 2016, and they lost that. So something is not working for him as a captain, the RCB, and I think he read the writing on the wall. And indeed, if you look at his ICC tournament record, whether it's a Champions Trophy, the World Cup, indeed, the World Championship of Cricket, he's not won an ICC tournament. These are things that I'm sure he's a proud man, and it must be hurting him somewhere. But eventually, you've got to bite the bullet. I think he's bitten the bullet, at least for the T20 format. He's giving it up to Rohit Sharma after the T20 World Cup. And he's really hoping that he can make the most of this T20 World Cup opportunity to win something and have something behind his name is the winner of an ICC tournament. But I think it's only a matter of time before the ODI captaincy also moves to Rohit. That's personal opinion. And then who knows what happens with the test captaincy. But at least, I mean, the way that he performed in England, the team performed, I think we were all extremely happy with the way that his tactics, his strategy, all these things worked out. So I think you're going to have a team where there are going to be two captains, one for the white ball format and one for the red ball format. But this the writing was on the wall. I think he read it and read it in time and took the plunge.
And Sunil, are you on board with the term batter being incorporated into the laws of the game? Gets used all the time, doesn't it? In the IPL in particular, I've heard Virat Kohli refer to himself as a batter numerous times.
Yeah, well, I'm glad, you know, it's limited to that. I really am glad. I was reading the entire report about what happened at the ICC and about the different terms about where the third man should be third, you know, and well, the night watchman and all those other things. So as I think one of the English test players, the women player said, well, you know, I just call it deep third and short third, which is one way to go. But, you know, we talked about this.
I've been saying that in commentary, I think. Yeah.
We talked about it in terms of the 100 and how they were changing all the rules of the game. I personally felt it. I think Jim was very strong in his views as to, you know, there is an argot about it. There is a lexicon. There is a history about terminology in cricket. And I think you need to have a balance. And I think batter, all right, I'm willing to accept that. Is that the thin end of the wedge? I hope not.
All the terms in cricket are generic. But I understand that in terms of the development, the evolution of the game, that this change to the laws to officially use the description batters is necessary. Women have built a place for themselves in the last couple of years as significant athletes, professionals, more so than before. So they're doing it on the field. It doesn't matter what the names are. And I've never myself liked the expression batters, whether they're male, female, or whatever. I think it's more like the fish and chip shop or baseball, to be honest. They're batsmen and they're bowlers. It's third man. They bowl maiden overs. It's all part of the generic, as I say, expressions in the game. But I'm an old fuddy-duddy. Don't take any notice of me. There are a few dinosaurs around, and we'll just get on with our lives and enjoy the spectacle, whatever words we are going to use, because the words are changing, and perhaps that's a good thing for the look of the game.
And language is significant. Language is powerful, and there are women and girls who find that when they hear the term batsman applied university, it gives a sense that cricket is a male domain and it doesn't include them. And that is reason enough to call everybody a batter, to give that sense that cricket is for them. And I know that on Stumped, we speak so much about the global game, don't we, and cricket in the developing nations. And so I feel it's a very strong signal now that for any nation starting out in cricket who are looking at the laws of the game for the very first time, they come to it with a completely gender-neutral look at the game, which says it involves fielders, bowlers, batters, and it says that cricket is a sport for everyone.
From the BBC World Service, this is Stumped on All India Radio.
Now, last week on Stumped, we heard the first part of my interview with Tuba Sangar, who up until a few weeks ago was the development manager for women's cricket at the Afghanistan Cricket Board. She told us how she escaped the country after the Taliban takeover and how she's worried for the Afghanistan women cricketers who are still in the country. The Afghanistan's men's team are due to visit Australia for an historic test match in November. And I asked Tuba how she felt about Cricket Australia saying that they'd have no choice but to refuse to host Afghanistan's men for that match if women's cricket isn't allowed in the country.
I think in one hand, it's a good for women teams. We thankful that the support has. And on the other hand, it's, I think Afghanistan men team did a lot for Afghanistan. Because of our men team, I know a woman should play cricket as well. They did a lot sacrifice for men for Afghanistan.
In that instance, they're only talking about test cricket. No mention has been made of playing Afghanistan in T20 or one day international. But do you feel that any action by the international cricket community would actually help the situation for women cricketers. For example, if either test status was taken away or Afghanistan was suspended from all international cricket. Can you see whether that would actually help the situation or otherwise?
Not at all. Because, you know, I told you that a woman in Afghanistan knows about cricket because they're man team. When other countries take that opportunity from Afghan man team, you know, one thing that gives hope for Afghanistan is just cricket right now. So if other worlds take that happiness and these things from Afghanistan, I think it will not help. It will destroy the Afghanistan people hope. If the ICC or others country boycott with Afghanistan cricket, it will not help women to play cricket. We did very good in cricket. Other country, like, they have longer history than Afghanistan, but Afghanistan people just 20 or maybe 25 years they playing cricket and they did very good. So I think the other countries should come together and find a practical way. The one thing that can help take out these girls from Afghanistan to bring them in secure place. And then they should help these girls to play for Afghanistan from third country, you know, like Australia, like UK, like India is a good place for cricket. We can play for Afghanistan from other countries. Mm. I'm sure that situation that the Taliban came to Afghanistan, it's not going to be more than 1 or 2 years, because Afghanistan people, especially youths, are not like 25 years ago. When Taliban came to Afghanistan, right now they know their rights, they know what's their rights, and they are not accept whatever people say to do this.
Well, that was Tuba Sangar, the former development manager for Afghanistan's women's cricket. And you can hear the full interview online if you go to bbc.com/stumped. Well, that's all we've got time for this week on Stumped here on All India Radio. My thanks to Sunil Gupta, Jim Maxwell, and to you all for listening. And don't forget, you can keep in touch with the show during the week. We're at BBC WS Sport. Use the hashtag BBC Stumped so we see your message. In the meantime, stay safe and we'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Stumped is a BBC Sport production for the BBC World Service in association with the Australian Broadcasting Corporation and All India Radio.